So hello friends, welcome to my channel MN Coaching Center. So today I'm going to explain about that is the six my English first that is Robin Hood and his Merry Men. So Robin Hood, the man in the hood leaned against the stone portico, surviving the scene before him. It was a cobbled yard on open market square, although there was no market taking place today. On the northern side ran the city wall, as high as 5 men standing on each other's shoulders. The wall was of tan. A guard sat on the wall walk, sharpening a sword. At its western end stood the city gate, a tall gatehouse with oriel windows and two narrow loops. So Robin Hood, he is the man who is living in a woodland and in a stone patio. So he surviving the scene before him. So the surviving, how he was surviving before that scene. So it was a cobbled yard. There was a market in a open market in a square, although on that day there was no market going on. And you can see in the northern side there is a city wall that is in the height of a 5 men who can stand upon their shoulders. 5 men stands in the shoulder. That height is that city wall. And the city wall is made up of grey stone and deep maroon, and that is also in deep maroon in color. And a guard sitting near that gate, and he was sharpening his sword. And in the western end, stood the city gate. It was a gatehouse with some windows and two loops. So below were two heavy oak doors that were shut at curfew every sunset. Beside them was the guardhouse. In the half light of dawn, one guard rested, leaning on this quarterstaff. Another lay slumped across a wooden bench, fast asleep. On the gloom of the church porch, his brown homespun hood threw a sharp morning shadow across his weathered face. On the southern side of the square, several houses and taverns nestled together. Some had stone walls and tiled roofs, but most were made of wattle and dub wood and thatch. Behind these narrow streets, a maze of alleyways snaked deep into the city. A dog barked light from rush tapers and flicked through at the open window. Wood smoke circled lazily above the rooftops. The smells of bread baking and the cooking of onion both wafted across the squares. Heavy eats, shopkeepers and yawning tradesmen were already putting up their both hand, but not in the center of the cobbled yard today. There was other business to be done today. The sky brightened into streaks of indigo and copper. A man in a surf smock pushed a hay cart, and in the open stables beside the city gate, a group of beggars clustered around a burning brazier. A gang of dirty-faced urchins shouted and jostled each other, chasing a soft leather ball. A woman wearing a hide cap with earpiece sold harpies from the cookhouse beside the square. A minstrel unrolled himself from a bundle of crazy woolen blankets where he had spent the night of the church steps. The city gates were thrown for space. Some of the women folks had baskets of food over their arms, intent upon the occasion. Still, walkers and jugglers were there. Kennel keepers and kitchen maids, a man with a scar down his cheek, shouted his expertise as a badger, another a skill in pulling teeth. So, as he saw in the northern side, now he's seeing two people. So he is seeing the two heavy oak doors. So there was a door in that gate. So there, that way shut out curfew every Sunday, every sunset. So after the night, after a sunset happens, the doors of that wall was shut down. Beside them was the guardhouse. So beside that door, it was a guardhouse there. In the half light of the dawn, one guard was resting and another was taking care. Next, in the eastern side of the yard, there was a castle, and Robin tucked his arm into his sleeves of his cloak. So he tucked his arm and backed into the gloom of the church porch. Next, in the southern side of the square, several houses and taverns nestled together. So several houses were there in the southern side, and some of them was made up of stones, but more was made up of wood and other materials. Behind this, a narrow small maze of hallways in the deep into the city, that was in the middle deep in the city. There a dog was barking. So light from rush was coming from an open window. The light was coming from an house. Wood smoke was there on the rooftops, and the smell of bread was coming from shopkeepers, and yawning tradesmen were putting up their booths, but not in the center of the Kubal yard today. So they were not putting their shops in the not in the center, they were putting in the some other place. These were there was other business to be done today. So there was the other business to done today. That is the there was a sky was brightening. A man pushed a heavy cart, a man was pushing the cart, and some of the bakers were trying to catch the balls, and also a gang of dirty shirts were also trying to catch the balls. And then a woman wearing a cap with earpieces, she was holding the hot bread pieces. Next, the city gates were open the next morning after the night over. Next morning, the city gates were open, and a throng of farmers, foresters, and out-of-towners jostled each other for space. So they ran inside the city for their space, for their shop space. They ran, and some of the women were having the basket of fruits, and still they were walking. So a man with a scar down his cheek. A man was shouting his expertise as a barber. So a man was shouting that I am a barber, you can do hair cuttings here. And another a skill in pulling teeth. So another showing his skill of pulling the teeth. A soldier on the city wall were marched out and inspected and returned to their post. A group of men at arms rode up, their mail shirts clinking beneath linen. The grooms, they centered about the marketplace buying small loaves and bowls of hot pottage from a family cooking, a stew of onion, meat and other things. A sense of expectation hung in the air, and a space had been cleared at the center of the square. A high wooden platform had been erected there, and on top of it stood a glass frame. Two upright posts of solid oak were fastened to a horizontal beam, so a hangman's noose dangled free. Some chickens scratched in the dirt around the spots. Robin smiled and drew his palmer's crown around him for warmth, and it was going to be a eventful day. Next, so as the tickets were open, all the people were rushing somewhere, saying that they are the barber and barber, and other were saying that they are showing the skills of pulling the teeth. So the soldiers, the guards who were taking the security of the gates, no one should come in. So the soldiers took a march and inspected, and then they returned back to their post. So after that, people came, so with an blue and yellow of Sir Guy of Gisborne, and they were leaving their horse there, and they were starting the marketing. They were buying the meals, onion, meat, barley, and other rice. And there was an expectation in the hand that they may buy ours. And a space had been cleared at the center of that square. There was a place where left, and a high wooden platform has been there in the place. So two upright posts of solid oaks were fastened, and a hangman was dangled free, and some chickens were stretched in. Going to be eventful day, he smiles and he says. Next, much the miller's sons. So much sat chewing on the straw, his back against the wooden planks of the guard house. He was sweating despite of chill in the morning air. He fumbled carefully in the load of hay beside him and pulled out a jar of home-brewed meat. Jesu, he groaned. He took some raisins and a small apple from a pocket in his and made a simple breakfast. Then he rubbed his eyes with his fists stretched and rolled his head backward. The timber-framed building jutted out above him, giving him some shelter from the beating wind. And the guards' sleeping quarters were up there, and he could hear the clatter and chatter of their morning activities. Much yawned, and sinking his chin onto his chest, he drew the rough hempen smoke about his knees and settled into a early morning doze. As usual, he dreamed of his father. Much the miller had a large red face. So the miller has a large red face, a broad smile, and arms that clasped you in a firm embrace. Everybody loved Much. The boy was only 12. The sheriff of Nottingham had burned his father's mill to make a better hunting ground for king's deer. The sheriff had caught his father killing a stag, and so had cut off the miller's two drawstring fingers. Later, the miller stalked and killed a red deer. This time, the sheriff burned the man's house to ground and was about to have his eyes put out when the old sheriff came alive with a roar of abuse. He tore himself from the soldier's grasp, grabbed a sword from one of them, and flayed about him in a wild fury. The sheriff's guards were dispatched with three powerful strokes. The miller was turning on the sheriff himself, sitting petrified. So let us know the first story, that is Much the Miller's Son. So after the marketing was started, in that sweet, very cool morning, then he took some apples from his pocket and he made some small breakfast. Then he rubbed his eyes, stretched and rolled his head backward. Then the timber-framed building jutted out above him and giving him some shelter from the beating wind. They were giving him some shelter for them. Then my yand, sinking his chin onto his chest, yes, and he drew the rough hempen smoke about his knees and settled into a early morning doze. He was settled. So as usual, the boy was dreaming about his father. So much the miller had a large red face. So the miller, his father was a miller, was named Miller. He had a red face, a broad smile. He was very, very much smiled, and arms that clasped you in the firm embrace. Everybody loved him very much. The boy was only 12 when his father was died. The boy, he means this guard, was very much only 12 when his father die. This Khan was sleeping, no? So his Khan's father, or that boy's father also, you can say, his father was only 12 years when he was only 20 years when his father died. But still he did not understand what happened on that day, why he killed. But he knew one thing, that the sheriff of Nottingham, a place called Nottingham, the sheriff of that place has burned his father's mill for making a wider hunting ground for the kings, for king's deer, making a hunting ground for king's deer. He killed his father, the sheriff. The sheriff fingers. Then later the miller stack, and then also he killed a red deer. This time the sheriff burned the man's house to the ground. Then next time also he killed another deer. Then this time the sheriff burnt his house. Next, with a roar of abuse, to tore himself from the soldier's grasp. Then the sheriff takes the sword from his soldiers, and then the sheriff guards were dispatched into three powerful strokes, and the miller was turning on the sheriff himself, and he was sitting on his black horse when an arrow took him in the back. Much the miller's son remembered that he was trying to lift his father off the ground. He was trying to take him up from the ground and shouting at him to wake up. He was trying to wake him up. Then he remembered the air thick with the smoke and his father unseeing eyes. So air was thick with smoke and his father's unseeing eyes. His father was not seeing. And he remembered those large arms lying helpless. Then he remembered that large arms that were helpless, that were not, they were not having help, and remembered little else. Much was simple-minded lad, but a loyal and as loving as any in the forest. So he was loyal and loving, very much he was loving by the people. And he wondered why the sheriff did not understand that men have to eat. He thought why the sheriff of that place did not understand that men also should eat. If you take away their livelihood, they cannot survive on herbs and roots. So if you take out their livelihood, they cannot survive on only eating some vegetables. Surely the king could spare a deer or two, but who was the king? So the king could give the deer or anything, but who was the king? So much thought it was the king was the king Richard. But Richard had left the country, and some said he was dead. So Richard the king has left the country, and some people says the king has died. These rumors were spread. Then his brother John had claimed the throne. So the king's brother John became the king, and John was constantly short of money. So John was not having money in that kingdom. So that was why the sheriff was taking people's land. So that's why the sheriff was taking the people's land and folk out their houses. So much sat up and tugged and his forelock, but the guard had already moved away. So the guards have moved away after killing the miller. Next, much felt for the dagger beneath his there was a smoke, and he drank some more meat and shook his head awake. Then he thought hard about the man who had let fly the arrow that had killed his father. So then he was thinking about who had put that arrow that my father has killed, and his name was Orman. Orman is the name who put that arrow, and his father was dead. Maid Marian. So Marian opened her eyes. She could see the first rays of the daylight slanting in through the high murdered hole windows. So through the high murdered hole windows, she can see the light. It took her a little moment to remember where she was. So then it took a little time to remember where she is. Then Nottingham Castle, Mother of God. So she is in Nottingham's Castle, Mother of God. There was a knock on the door. So there was someone knocking, and Mariana sat up. She waked up and quickly gathering her blankets around her. Sir Guy of Gisborne, open the door. She again they said, Sir Guy of Gisborne, open the door. and should silver the grey gloom of the stone cairoid. There was, it was grey. And Sir Guy was a tall man with a sandy hair. So he was a tall man. That man was very much tall with a sandy hair down to his shoulder. And he had pale blue lifeless eye. So he has a pale blue and lifeless eye. And a sensuous mouth. His top teeth protruded slightly over a receding chin with a spotted a thin yellow beard. So he says, I am a prisoner. So that he says, I am a prisoner. Demanded Mariana. So demanded Mariana. Certainly not. Replying Sir Guy. So Mariana asks, is for the day, I would like you to accompany me to the morning's entertainment. So I would like to accompany you to my morning entertainment. If I am not a prisoner, said Mariana, then I am free to go. So Mariana says, if I am not a prisoner, then I can go now. Sir Guy did not answer, but his cheeks grew hot. Then he did not answer, but he was a little bit angry. Mariana wrapped the blankets about her and walked over to the casement. So she took the blankets and she gone casement out. Below was the kobold lad with the hangman's nose at its center. So with an hangman's nose, that kobold lad that you used to see in the first that was there. From up in the tower, the people looked like knees as they shurried about, taking up their places for the hanging. So for starting their shop, the people were very much hurried. Where are you, Robin? She breathed. So she breathed, take the breath, and she asked, where are you, Robin? She looked out over the city walls and woodland, which stretched to the horizontal and across the thick green forest. She everywhere. The air was sharp, but spring was on the way. The air was very much sharp, very fast. Then, your father is waiting. I am here to take you to him. So he says, your father is waiting. I am here to take you to him. Does he expect me in a state of undress? Does he expect me in a state of undress? He says, snapped Mariana, and she crossed the room and closed the door in Sir Guy's face. So she closed the door then. Then it was a while before Mariana appeared in the great hall. Then Sir Guy stood behind her, fingering his thin, pointy beard and staring at the own fly. So he was going behind her. Then is your wife. So he says, if you can't command her, then what can you do if she is your wife, if she became your wife? How can you do? Mariana sat down beside her father and served the fare. So then Mariana sat down beside her father and she served a fare. Next there were loaves of bread and small several meatballs. So there were bread and meatballs. Then there were cheesy wrapped in wine leaves and honey cake that was there. Do not upset yourself, father, Mariana said. Then, for I will never be married to Sir Guy. So Mariana said, I will never marry this Sir Guy. This person, you will do as I say. Snorted Lord Fitzwalter, his father name, Lord Fitzwalter, said, you will do what I say. He sat a formidable figure, staring down to at her, and you will wear the wimple, daughter. Yes, you will wear the wimple, daughter. You are a woman and should not show your hairs to all who care to look. You should not show the hairs. Then Mariana had plaited her hair into a honey brown cord as thick as bell rope. Then it caught light as she turned to look at the knights. It was very much light color, it was looking. She picked up a thick pastry and put it down again. I am not hungry, she said. So, next. The next story is Alan A. Daly. God's bones, murmured Alan. I am too old for this sort of thing. So, Alan, a person says, I am too old for these things to do. Then, he took a few deep breaths and then he So this was the early ballads of Robin Hood do not include Maid Marina. The first mention of her comes in a series of poems that called as Ship of Follies by Alexander Barclay. The character who generally appear in Robin's originally gang are Little John's Will Scatter, that is Robin's nephew, and much the Miller's sons. Miller's son will come in this story. But she is the extra character also, you can say. In old days, he thought with a smile. He carried a straw pellet. Now he had only a few woolen blankets to keep out the cold. He had only some woolen blankets, that's all. Alan's face was lean and his sun-rinsed copper hair greying above the ears. Then his hair like copper color, that is the brown. A thick beard set off two burying hazel eyes. So with the eyes, he was set off. There was a knowing look in that gaze. So there was a knowing, yeah, that she knows in that scene, in that view like that. Then Alan had seen more winters than any of Robin's men. So Alan has seen more winters because he was having one blanket, so winter, yeah, you know. Then he traveled more miles and seen more sights. So he had traveled, Alan has traveled more miles. Then so the draw inched up, and with it a keen north country wind. So a keen north country wind, and Alan shivered. Then he smelled wood smoke and meat cooking. Then a donkey bread. He watched that huckster and foresters flocking through the gates, and he noted the beggars by the brazier and the woman stealing pottage under the. Lines from the old remembered songs. He was using that string to hear the remember the song. Yesterday I should have married a maid, but she is from Metain and choose to be an old knight's delight, whereby my heart is slain, he says. So okay friends, till here I'll stop. I will explain the other topic other time in my next video. So okay friends, till here you understand, I think so. So I will see you in my next video. Till then, take care, have a nice day. Bye my dear friends.